Okay, it grants Sucker Punch, and he already has it, so let's give it to Aretas. There you go. Enjoy. The holographic panel appears to be a control interface. In the center is what looks like a utility map of Sega's cliffs. It's surrounded by a number of symbols you cannot immediately identify, and in the upper right quadrant is some sort of cube within a cube. Strange as the panel is, you can't shake a strong sense of familiarity about it. Examine the interface closely. The map of Sagus has a number of locations highlighted, some of which you recognize. There are four symbols around it. A circle that looks like the sun, a cluster of stars, a triangle of three eyes, and what looks like a crystal lattice. All the symbols are lit except for the crystal lattice. Larger than all four symbols is a cube within a cube, which you suddenly remember is called a tesseract. It appears to be moving. Awesome. Tesseract flickers in and out as though it's not always there. Try to remember why this feels familiar before I start touching and messing with things. Doing this, I might be more successful with this stuff. Let's go all the way. I can only get 60. Probably gonna be resting again soon. A memory emerges, as clear as if it were happening to you right now. Success. You are at a cracked door at the base of a stairwell. The door squeaks quietly as you ease it open. Your breath catches in your throat, but the Tabat soldiers outside don't notice you. You squeeze through the door, a keen-eyed young girl behind you, and slip out of the tower down the bloodstained corridor and into the city. The city is under attack. You dash through the streets to the nearest of your generators. Pressing a couple of buttons, you and the girl are teleported elsewhere. This reminds me of the beginning of the game. We were under attack. And I was speaking to a girl. I think it was a girl. I don't know if it's the same, if this is the same, like, memory. Like, the continuation. It was in the beginning. Way in the first episode. Dark Fathom. We were clicking on two or three of, like, memory locations and pulling up random stuff like this. And also with the clock, there was a note about one of the times was regarding the city being under attack by the Tabat. You find yourself in front of the very same control panel atop the cliff. With quick movements, you shift the tesseract, slipping the controls from space to time. Cool. Then you press the cluster of stars to connect the network of temporal shield generators. On the map, the network of generators burst to life, sharing energy across the city to create an enormous shield over all of Sega's cliffs. Huh. Using the power of time somehow? Temporal shield. So we use time, the power of time, to make shields over the city. The dome of energy fills the city, unmooring the city from time itself. On the other side of the shield, the world shifts and shimmers, objects and landscape appearing and disappearing before your eyes. The place is the same, you realize, but you're seeing it in many different time periods at once. The important thing is that no one can enter or exit the dome while the city is temporarily unmoored. That should buy the city's defenders the space they need to fight out the Tabat and survive. Okay, maybe not using it necessarily using the power of time in a direct way I was thinking, but using it to, you know, be literally unmoored from time. The memory fades. You stand above Caravanserai again. The interface is the same as the one from your memory, and you understand what at least some of these controls do. Try to determine the purpose of the various interface elements. You stare at the controls for several minutes, but can't seem to... but you can make no sense of them. It might be easier if you just tried them out to see what happens. Touch the sun symbol. Let me examine it again. Let's see. Touch the sun symbol to see what it does. The platform hums. The air pops and sizzles. For a few seconds, activity outside the platform shifts. People flicker in and out. Caravanserai changes. First the ships, and then the buildings themselves. You see them as old and deteriorated, then new, then under construction on the bare rock, all within seconds. Your platform remains steady, but outside, as if time is shift... Oh, it remains steady, but outside, as if time is shifting as swiftly as the sea. The platform shudders suddenly, then clicks off. The air cools and quiets, and Caravanserai returns the way it was. After keeping the energy dome active for so long, centuries or longer, it seems that the platform no longer has enough power to remain active. Connect the current network by pressing the cluster of stars. The bright points on the map grow even brighter, and the platform beneath your feet hums with a growing warmth. Thin strands of energy, barely visible in the sunlight, stretch across the city between each location on the map. At the same time, faded lines appear on the map connecting each point, a network of generators which this panel controls. Then, with a loud pop, the energy fades, the humming stops, and everything returns to the way it was. Huh. So that's time. This turns on the generators. Or, I think. Touch the three eyes to see what they do. The map changes color. Each of the bright points lights up in turn, occasionally stretching a faded line from one point to another. After a minute of this, the map fades. A voice speaks the truth directly into your mind. Temporal network connections limited. Please repair the network. The crystal lattice next to the map lights up. Huh. Toggle, or I'm gonna mess with this, but first... Toggle the controls between space and time using the tesseract. As soon as you touch it, the impossible cubes shift and move with your fingers. It seems to snap into different states. With unfamiliar gestures, you rotate the tesseract. The inner cube squeezes out and becomes the outer cube, while the outer cube becomes the inner one. Some of the locations lit up on the map change. Among other locations, two new lights appear at Caravanserai. One mocking the platform where you're standing. The outer cube moves in space, no longer flickering as it was before. Presumably, the controls are now set to the spatial dimension. The crystal lattice next to the map dims again. I press the sun. The entire platform hums to life, and a sphere of electricity shimmers about 5 meters above your head. After a few moments, the humming winds down, the sphere fades, and all is silent again. The stars. The bright points on the map grow even brighter, and the platform beneath your feet hums with a growing warmth. Faded lines appear on the map connecting each point, a network of machines which this panel controls, including two locations in Caravanserai. Then with a loud pop, the humming stops, and the map returns as it was. What's this other location? Press the eyes. The map changes color. Each of the bright points, in turn, lights up, occasionally stretching a faded line from one point to another. After a minute of this, the map fades. A voice speaks the truth directly into your mind. Spatial network connections limited. Please repair the network. Crystal lattice next to the map lights up. Okay, let's touch it. Again, the map lights up and changes colors. Lights appear between each point. Some are faded, while others have gaps in them. One by one, each line becomes brighter and better connected to the rest. After several minutes, the map shows a network of points. The control panel ceases its activity, and the voice speaks to you again. Spatial network restored. Connection procedure may now proceed. Hmm. Yeah, the Tesseract moves through space instead of flickering as it was before. I noticed that. Alright, press the sun. The entire, yeah, sphere of electricity, blah blah blah. Okay. Cluster of stars. The map lights up again. And the voice speaks into your mind. Spatial translation network connected. State your destination. You don't recognize the location of all the points, so you don't know what name the machine expects. But you do know some of them. Huh. Well, this is new. Colm Village. Meal Avast. Do I really want to be going there right now? Huh. Cliff's Edge. The entire platform hums to life. The air sparks and crackles around you. Then with a pop, you are somewhere else. Huh. I'm wondering...
As you wish.
Just where we've been before. See, I was wondering if we might go here. But no. Caravanserai's... this one. Do I have to travel up every time? Unless we're supposed to use that thing. Hold on, let me go back. Maybe that's what these things are for. There's a few, like, things that we don't... There's one in Circus Minor I saw. Few of these landmarks that we don't know what they do.
Yes.
Only one of the consoles surrounding the machine is working. Flicking lights gleam beneath the layers of grime and corruption. It's a generator. A corrosion. A jumble of mismatched parts make up this once functional generator. You notice a familiar cercinate symbol etched into the metal like a maker's mark. You thumb a button beneath the flickering light and feel an odd, painful sensation below your navel. It is as if someone has slipped a hook into your flesh and is tugging it from the other ends of three very long lines. One is attempting to draw you in the direction of Circus Minor, another is pulling you towards the peak of the city, and a third, the one that feels almost taut, traces an invisible line back to Caravanserai, where the teleportation control panel was. Caravanserai. The invisible line yanks you up into the roaring darkness. Where's the peak of the city? Okay. Let's interact with this thing. The machine hums softly. An orange glow appears beneath its dark, glossy surface. A large alien symbol dominates the space, with words in a smaller script on the side, but you cannot understand the writing. Even so, it feels like you've seen the writing somewhere before. Let's try to decipher the text. My god, we have so much to do. Success. After studying the text for several minutes, you begin to see, or perhaps simply remember, patterns in the words. In a flash, the purpose of the device comes back to you. This is an Omniscope, a device used to view locations from afar. The large alien symbol is actually an inhuman handprint. The longer list next to it is a set of location names, and the shorter list denotes ranges of time, how far back in time the Omniscope should look. You discover that you can actually read them all. Look at the list of locations. This is exciting, guys. We're going to spend forever here. There are 8 locations listed, all of them within or near Sega's cliffs. Selecting one will presumably shift the Omniscope to look in that direction. Caravanserai is currently selected. Let's select the Reef of Fallen Worlds. You touch the name and it glows brighter than the others. Far above you, the Omniscope shifts into a new position. Huh. Is that all that happens? Look at the list of approximate times. There are 3 numbers here, representing a rough time frame. Perhaps days, months, or years. The numbers are strange, but you are fairly certain you understand their meaning. Selecting one will presumably direct the Omniscope to look at that time frame. The current selection is 1, which you take to mean the present. You have the current selection. The machine continues its soft hum. Place your hand on the alien handprint. As soon as you place your hand on the surface, the machine reacts. The glowing items on the 2 lists blink and draw lines to a rectangle, a view screen that wasn't there before. Dozens of buildings are built into the cliffside. Many of them hang precariously over the sea below. We're looking at cliff's edge. The people of this area are, for the most part, rough and bitter. They don't live on the edge by choice. So if I look again, it's going to be the same. Look at the list of approximate times. Select 12 to look at the recent past. You touch the number and it grows brighter than the others. The machine's humming changes in timbre. Same. The image in the view screen changes rapidly, showing the cliffside over weeks and days. Buildings collapse into the sea quickly, as if something were undermining them. Yeah, the Stika. ...128 to look at the distant past. Same. The image in the view screen changes rapidly, showing the cliffside over many years. The further back in the past you look, the more buildings there are. They have been falling gradually into the sea over many centuries. Above and below, there are seaward-facing batteries, defensive weapons that predate the Ninth World. But they too collapse into the sea as the years pass. Shortly before the distant past ends, the last of them topples from its perch, leaving the city defenseless. So, okay, well, look at all this crap, right? Reef of Fallen Worlds. One to look at the present. You see the half-sunken buildings and artifacts of the Reef of Fallen Worlds, where you crashed into the Earth. Very few scavengers trawl the reef, perhaps because they believe there is nothing more to be found, or perhaps out of fear. How about the recent past? This is awesome, I love this. The most interesting occurrence in this time frame is when you fell. There's a bright flash. You can see Allegern and Callistes watching the skies, and Allegern twists his hands in the air, sending multicolored energy up into the sky. Alright. He softened our fall, somewhat. Seconds later, a white streak, encased in the same energy, slams into the crystal dome at the edge of the reef. Huh. Maybe he did more than that. Okay. Distant past. The first thing you notice is the construction of a synth dome, the same dome you crashed into when you fell to Earth. A man with a cast-off tattoo works alongside various automatons. The cast-off is wearing tattered leather robes. An alarming number of wires and tubes protrude from his body. Little else changes until you reach images from many centuries past. Massive war constructs crawl across the reef, firing weapons toward the city above. One of them is struck by a blast from a defensive battery, and it collapses into the crystalline water. As it settles, you recognize its back as the place where you met Koro. There was nothing before that assault upon the city. When you try to look further into the past, the images loop back to the present and start over. Okay. Government Square. The present. The bright sunlit square is home to many elaborate buildings. A few of these are made of metal and seem to burst forth from the ground itself. The people here shine as much as the square itself. They are well dressed and obviously wealthy. Many levies walk the square, as well as Aeon priests, foreigners, and a few non-humans. Okay, let's look at the recent past. A pale woman with yellow hair stands in front of a magical gateway. Occasionally, you see children enter or exit the portal, though never the same child twice. Yes. Found that out. So I guess we'd find this out. This would help us with some of our quests, I'm supposing. Now, like if we had to figure out that side quest. It's like 128 for the distant past. Centuries ago, there was some kind of rebellion. It spilled out from the bloom up to the highest parts of Sega's cliffs. Leading the charge is a woman wielding a glowing hammer. She's covered entirely in silver scales. She doesn't even have a face that you can see. Her followers are numerous, and the leaders of ancient Sagas are quickly killed or subdued. Okay. Caravanserai, I think. Present? Does it say the same thing it always does? Yeah. The screen shows the plateau of Caravanserai. It looks exactly as the scene before you. Not surprising. Recent past. Travelers come and go, though the ships with the fish-like passengers or goods marked for Emra, Mirage, Julios remain in their docks for a long time. The docks have been a bustling center of trade for as far back in time as you can see. In the earliest recorded time, you can see two figures standing atop this very observation platform, a male and a female. Bright flashes and gouts of smoke suggest a great battle taking place along the cliffs below, until the man activates something on the control panel, and a faint veil of energy encircles the city, and the tumult suddenly ends. Right. The Tabat. And then he activated this. Alright, so these keep changing. Circus Minor. You see the bustling city square near the bottom of the cliffs. People of all types mingle about, show off their wares, or entertain the crowds. The crowd surrounding the execution ground has dispersed. Okay, yeah, we're gonna change to recent past. I guess when the execution was going on. you see a vibrant parade. In the center is a man bound in chains. His expression tells you he is walking to his death. Elegern and Calistes pass, conferring quietly, as they make their way towards the steps that lead to the reef. Right, they're heading to go find me, or something. And now, the distant past. Buildings rise and fall as time passes. One in particular catches your attention. It is built from purple rock and rises perfectly straight, perhaps 50 stories tall. On its side is a magnificent mural of a creature, or perhaps a tree or a storm, but you feel certain it is a creature. Perhaps the creature, the sorrow that is hunting you. A mural, huh? The building stood for centuries before it was torn down. Why did they have a mural? And why was it torn down? Randomly or because the mural was there? Let's go to... New areas, the bloom. Let's look at the present. We have never seen this, guys. The screen shows the dark chasm that flanks Sagus Cliffs on one side. At the bottom of the chasm is a carpet of debris that seems to flow like a river from the junkyard north of the city down to the sea. In the darkest part of the chasm, beneath a cloud of greasy smoke, is a city-sized mass of living flesh. The Bloom. Its name springs readily to mind, plucked from your sire's memory. Tubes and tendrils sprout from the bloom in 100 directions, many of them attached to the cliffs on either side. So it doesn't... It's attached, it doesn't wander. Merchants and other scattered figures travel along the bloom's tendrils. A stone gatehouse, partially subsumed within the mass of flesh, would seem an obvious entrance, but very few are coming or going through its gates. A number of scavengers sift through the debris outside the bloom, tossing most of what they find into the bloom's many orifices. Feeding it? Okay. Recent past. Same. The bloom sees a lot of diverse traffic. Merchants, refugees, and the destitute. A number of shady figures enter and exit, mostly through a stone gatehouse that is partially subsumed within the mass of flesh. Not a single Levy or Sagus official ever seems to travel here. So they used to go through the gatehouse, no more. Maybe it's too much subsumed within the mass of flesh? Oh. I meant to do this. Distant past.
I'm ready to become even more heroic!
All these things have been here for a long time. The further into the past you look, the farther north the bloom is. It looks like it is moving very slowly south over time, less than a finger's length per year, toward the sea. Huh. Okay, now... Crufton? Present. I don't know what these blazes are. I mean, I've heard of the bloom, but I don't know what these other two are. The screen shows an area north of Sagus Cliffs below the crag of the city, where the land stretches out to the horizon. Amidst a maze of bluffs and outcroppings is all manner of debris, most of it predating the Ninth World. Metal and synth monoliths rise above a field of scrap. A functioning machine perches on the edge of an enormous pit. Strange plants and vines struggle to reclaim the land. It's even more cluttered and fantastic than the Reef of Fallen Worlds. Scavengers wander the maze, not all of them human. They pick out what other Numenera or scraps they can find. Recent past? The view screen displays the junkyard north of Sagus Cliffs, so it is a junkyard. It is cluttered with thousands, perhaps millions of years of debris from prior worlds. Strange plants and vines are growing over and between everything, gradually reclaiming the land.
I'm ready to become even more heroic!
Scavengers come and go. A small campfire catches your eye, an oddity in the junkyard. Rin's small figure hunches over it. She looks scared. What? Rin, where are you? I want to help her, she just can't adventure with us. I mean, maybe she can, but I don't want her to. If I could find her, I could ask her about that. It looks like this guy's watching us here. Distant past. Scavengers come and go. The enormous pit grows slowly larger. In the more distant past, a wall stretches across the junkyard, bristling with northward-facing batteries to protect the city from attack. But as time passes, the wall is abandoned, the batteries crumble into ruin, and the whole structure is subsumed beneath the surrounding trash. So what if this place is attacked again? We don't have all this stuff to protect it.